Our candle of concern is lit for everyone in our church family, in our community, in our country, and across the globe, who has felt the isolation, sickness, and loss during this debilitating time of pandemic. May we find the strength to support each other as the wave continues. We light the Christ candle as a reminder that God is with us in this crisis and all crises. The Christ remains constant with us always, even in our most trying times.
Welcome to what we hope will be our last edited online service from Grace United Church in Gananoque. Starting next week, October 4th at 10:30, we will be live streaming our service and you will be able to watch the service at church time or later. Little did I know from our start from scratch in March how much there was to learn about worship and video editing. And yet, once the software was acquired and a routine established, the process actually became quite easy and creatively rewarding, if time-consuming. I need to thank the many people who have helped make these services happen. First and foremost, our pastoral care and education coordinator, Donna Norman, who crafted a service each week. From choice of hymns to a welcoming call to worship, to a meditation full of food for thought for a Christian in today's world, from prayers to the benediction, Donna's gift as a worship leader and her attention to the technical aspects of video worship made my job easier and served our congregation well. Tammy Ferguson contributed to our services both as a congregant and as a student in the lay ministry training program. We have appreciated David Charles' minutes for mission, which have reminded us that we have responsibilities beyond our own community and country. We appreciate Colleen Harding for taking on the task of arranging for greeters and readers each week, and members of the congregation who so readily embrace the technology to carry out these tasks. I won't name everyone else, but I must express my heartfelt appreciation to all the greeters, readers, and musicians who contributed their talents to making our services meaningful for our viewers. Countless hours of musical offerings were made available to us at no cost. From live performances recorded on a phone to complex YouTube videos, we appreciate each and every musical offering. And thank you to our viewers for your comments and words of encouragement. As we move into the church building next week, we will share information about how to view the service if you are unable to attend in person. Meanwhile, grab a cup of your favorite beverage and enjoy this week's service. Welcome.
Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Like the hymnist says, "You call from tomorrow, O God, and you break ancient schemes. You challenge us to dream, to have visions, to clear our eyes, so that we may rise as your people. It is sometimes easy to say that we are your hands and feet in this world. It is sometimes very difficult to be that presence. Oftentimes, the rush of your wind is drowned out by our need to simply get through each day. Call us once again, O Great One. Blow through us once again on the rush of the wind. Call us to be your presence, even in this pandemic world. Amen."
Amen. morning, friends. Dave Charles, your mission service enthusiast, hopefully doing his last of the remote sessions on Minutes for Mission. As you can see, I'm up bright and early in my backyard on Friday as I get ready to go and close up our cottage in Chelsea, Quebec. A lot of activities going on. Today's topic, by the way, is the Bissell Center offers hope and housing help. And I just want to comment on that initiative along with a lot of other issues going on in mission and service in the United Church. Recently, some of you who may get the Essentials newsletter may have seen the establishment of the United Property Resource Corporation, which the United Church of Canada is going to work with the Canadian Mortgage and Housing Corporation with a line of credit of $20 million to hopefully build up to 5,000 homes for people who struggle to get homes in the next 15 years. Very similar to some of the other housing projects you may have seen around. And I think it's great that the church is taking leadership in that area. Also, there was a message from the moderator and lobbying with the government to continue the proposal of a guaranteed annual income for Canadians. In our new changing society, there has to be a new mindset in terms of every person should make at least a minimum amount of money each year to support themselves. Yes, we do understand the Protestant work ethic, but the times they are changing, and it's not necessarily that easy for everyone to get a job in a much restructured economy. And to bridge through that, this annual income a guarantee is a great step. And the other thing going on in the area is I was recently invited through our session group to be a participant, a liaison with the Gananoque and Area Food Access Network led by Marie Trainer. This network is going to help provide residents in our area with food literacy information and some foods. There are community gardens that you may be aware of that are harvested and provided to residents. And also we're looking at ways that we can provide sometimes excess foods that restaurants and grocery stores have. So a great initiative, especially hits me personally because my daughter Christy, as some of you may know, is a registered dietitian. Her work currently is with nursing homes. But she's always pounded into me the need to have a better diet and also to help those around us with their food needs. Things like we do through the food bank, which I believe as of today is moving down near where Bravo is, which should be great for access. So let's get on with today's reading. And again, it's called The Bissell Center Offers Hope and Housing Help. Our mission and service grants for community ministries like Bissell Center's Outreach Housing Team offers hope for a safe, more prosperous future to many people like Joe. Joe had been living on the streets when he first moved to Edmonton to be closer to his children. His first visit to Bissell Center was for a shower and clean clothing. Afterward, he found a group of people sleeping under a gazebo together, using an electric blanket covered by a tarp to keep warm that night. We slept under there, huddled together, just hoping to wake up in the morning, he said. But after being robbed and left to freeze one night, Joe needed to make a change. Bissell Center's support workers helped him find an affordable apartment and piece his life back together. There were some nights when I wasn't sure if I'd survive. If it wasn't for the Bissell Center, I'd probably have frozen out there, he said. But now I'm okay. I have kids and family back, and I have a lot of support. And I have a beautiful home to call my own. He has a job, and he volunteers at the center to give back to the community. None of this would have been possible without mission and service. With additional support from Gifts with Vision, over 45 people housed through the Bissell Center's outreach housing team were given a gift when they moved into new housing last year. Items such as pots and pans, utensils, linens, made them feel more at home. Funds were also used to purchase bus tickets to help people get to apartment viewings, secure new identification, or obtain a criminal record check. So as you can see, Your givings to mission service support a lot of needs in the communities and in this area, particularly housing. And I mentioned earlier, there's big moves going on within the United Church to provide more homes like Habitat for Humanity does to help local residents seek places to live. And with that, this concludes our final virtual Mission Minutes for Mission. Hope to see most of you folks next Sunday. And I've heard a lot of good feedback in terms of my ability to share videos about some of the projects going on, such as we did last week on the helping farmers in Cuba. So with some new technology we're working on the church, we hope to be able to provide that those kind of videos both in the sanctuary and when we need to shoot it out virtually. We'll make sure you see that latest information. Take care. Have a great Sunday.
This is Brian Brooks, and it's my pleasure to read the scripture for today's service. But before I do that, however, and as chair of the Grace Official Board, I wish to say a few words about a very special lady in our community of faith, namely Donna Norman. Donna, along with many others, has been instrumental in preparing and presenting the weekly services in which, my opinion, have kept Grace together since the pandemic struck and forced us to close our doors. On behalf of the official board, Donna, and for that matter, all the members of Grace Church, thank you for being there when it was needed the most. Because of you, although the building was closed, the church was not. Now, today's reading is Matthew chapter 21, verses 23 to 32, the question of Jesus' authority. Jesus came back to the temple, and as he taught, the chief priests and elders came to him and asked, "What right do you have to do these things? Who gave you such right?" Jesus answered them, "I will ask you just one question, and if you give me an answer, I will tell you by what right I have to do these things. Where did John's right to baptize come from? Was it from God or was it from human beings?" They started to argue among themselves. If we say from God, he will say to us, "Why then did you not believe John?" But if we say from human beings, we are afraid of what the people might do, because they are all convinced that John was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you then by what right I do these things. Now, what do you think? There once was a man who had two sons. He went to the older one and said, 'Son, go to work in the vineyard today.' 'I don't want to,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. 'Yes, sir,' he answered. But he did not go. Jesus asked, 'Which one of the two did what the father wanted?' The older one, they answered. So Jesus said to them, 'I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John the Baptist came to you, showing you the right path to take, and you would not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prophets believed him. Even when you saw this, you did not later change your minds and believed him.'" Word of the Lord.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. May the words of my mouth be acceptable to you, O God, and may they inspire reflection. Amen. If you had told me a year ago that I would be involved in leading worship each Sunday in an online YouTube video, I would have probably told you, "Thanks, but that's not something I know how to do. I can never do that. I have no idea where to even start." At least in my own mind, I said no to the challenge. I doubted that I was capable of the task. But in reality, I took a leap of faith and said yes. And so here we are, 7 months later, joining in perhaps, hopefully, the last of our series of online worship experiences at Grace Church in Gananoque. I am the first to say that all this would not have happened without the extraordinary talents of Paul Harding, who patiently led me through the production process, who spent countless hours creating beautiful musical offerings, editing, finessing, and coaching, and simply being a sounding board for me and others on our worship team each week. We are indebted to Colleen, who coordinated the volunteers each week, and to the crew of greeters and readers who contributed so freely of their time and talents. Dave Charles and his Minute for Mission became a welcome addition to our service each week. I often think, what if I had listened to my inner doubts and said no to this opportunity to grow in my own faith, a faith that has been shaped by the so many lessons I have learned over many years working and living with people who are largely marginalized. If I had said no, I would not have the memory of my father in his 91st year leading my own community of faith in online communion. A first for all of us, a precious memory that still moves me. To the people of Grace Church, I owe a huge debt for having faith in me, for having patience with me, for encouraging me, and for simply hearing me out each week. No doubt I've stumbled along the way, but your support has been immeasurable. Thank you. Needless to say, all these thoughts brought me to consider today's scripture reading in a new light. The parable of the two sons is unique to Matthew's gospel. A father calls his eldest son to go work in the vineyard. He refuses, but later relents and goes to work. The father then asks his second son to go to work. The son quickly agrees, perhaps to simply placate his father, but he never actually goes. I'd even like to give him the benefit of the doubt and say that perhaps he fully intended to go to work, but life got in the way and he never actually got around to it. As in many of Jesus' teachings, he tells a story and then asks his listeners to answer a question. Which one of the two did as his father asked? At first glance, the answer seems straightforward. Of course, the first son did the father's will. But look closely. We can see that both sons brought dishonor to the father. The first by his words, the second by his deeds. Neither really appeared to respect the authority of their father. Perhaps neither son was in the right. Perhaps they were both, in the truest sense, saying yes and living no. I also had to ask myself, what kind of brother, or in my case, sister, am I? Scholars say that in relating this parable of Jesus, Matthew probably meant it as a summons to the Jewish leaders to imitate the first son and join the community of faith in believing in Jesus. He also perhaps meant to encourage those Christians who had initially said yes and then they wavered from their new path that Jesus had shown them. Jesus says to the good religious folks, "Truly, I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the dominion of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." God's grace, says Jesus, is indiscriminate. God's grace cannot be earned. It lets disrespectful sons, crooked tax collectors, and prostitutes into the dominion of God ahead of upstanding religious people. It can't be earned. And the response of those Jewish authorities, well, we know what happened. In essence, they played their hands so that the government nailed Jesus to a tree and left him to die. Wow. Jesus' words and deeds really were a threat to the status quo, to the system, the hierarchy. And yet, I have to say that there is a part of this that is very uncomfortable with all of this. The notion that God's grace is given freely and indiscriminately. After all, I try to live a good life. I am at once the younger son, the elder brother, the law-abiding Pharisee, the worker in the field. I follow the rules. I'm one of the faithful. I work hard to say yes and live yes, to live out my words in my actions. Am I to be treated the same in God's eyes as the prostitute, the tax collector, the poor? Shouldn't they be required to clean up their act at least a little bit? Shouldn't they be held just a little bit accountable for their lifestyles, their actions? It all seems so unfair somehow. And then I take a deep breath. I am forced to admit my vulnerability, my sense of entitlement. I am forced to acknowledge these roadblocks, my sense of my rightful place when I refer to myself as a woman of God, my pride in my own respectable status in the community, my sense of accomplishment in my good works, all those things and feelings that I trust more than Jesus' teachings. The gospel of Jesus Christ declares that there is a place ahead of me for prostitutes and tax collectors in God's kingdom. A hard pill to swallow. But perhaps I'm the only one keeping a scorecard. Perhaps my image of the divine is much too small and is much too limited by my limited knowledge. Perhaps my understanding of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God, is too narrow. Perhaps my lack of imagination limits me. My small understanding of the divine prevents me from envisioning a God who is more gracious than I can ever imagine. Perhaps I would do better to celebrate the grace that I can see all around me in God's kingdom here on earth, in other people, in people from all walks of life, all circumstances and gifts, and with every kind of struggle imaginable. Over the past year, I've told you many stories of the extraordinary God moments in my life. Those fleeting times when I have stood on holy ground with someone else whose path in life is very different from my own, but with whom I share a moment of grace. A moment when the same Spirit that lives and breathes in me and around me also lives and breathes in another of God's children. Perhaps God's grace is not just dispensed from above. Perhaps we truly find grace in our individual lives by saying yes and living yes in all of our relationships with all of God's creation. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving God, it is so comforting to keep track of our good deeds, our faithful ways. Help us to realize that your grace is abundant, given freely to us and through us in this hurting world. Amen.
They will bear you up. dash your foot against a stone.
Let us bring the prayers of our church family before God. Let us pray. Loving God, in these trying times, it is sometimes all too easy to turn inward and to feel only our own hurt and frustration and longing. Sometimes just getting through another day relatively unscathed is our goal. For some of us, the ache of isolation and loneliness is always just below the surface. For some of us, the pressure of taking care of families, educating our children, not feeling secure in the workplace, not being with our loved ones, worrying about those we love and feeling overwhelmed by it all. Sometimes there's just little room for being inspired. We know that the winds of change are beginning to blow, that inevitable change that brings hope and relief, but also anxiety and uncertainty. Help us to hear the small voice in the midst of the rushing wind that says, "Be still and know that I am God." The same voice that challenges us to be your people in this hurting world. Today we pray for those who are most vulnerable, our loved ones in care homes, in hospitals, and all those who are isolated at home. Inspire the leaders of this land of plenty that we call Canada to make wise decisions about the welfare of everyone, not just a privileged few. Give us all the courage to make sacrifices. Be with us in this coming week as we move our congregational life from online to the uncertain world of meeting as your people once again in our beautiful sanctuary. Give us the wisdom to make decisions that keep everyone safe and well. And now we offer prayers in silence for those things that we hold in our hearts. Be with us, O God. Help us to appreciate the unexpected joys that come our way in the midst of these difficult times. Give us the strength to face what each day brings. We ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
As we leave this space of worship today, let us renew our commitment, the commitment to say yes and live yes, even when doing so takes us into uncomfortable places and uncharted territory. Let us make bold new decisions and arise as God's people. And now, may the love of the Creator and the eternal spirit of gentleness go with you this week and always. Amen.